It's a backslash. It's a backslash. It's a backslash. In the previous video, I couldn't remember whether in a URL you put a backslash or a forward slash, and I thought maybe it's forward. It's a backslash. And this is quite extraordinary, tying that into the cell phone going back to 1970, January 11th, 1970. Going back to the future. Going back to the pivotal point in history, actually. When everything pivoted, the reason why the world is the way right now is that pivotal time in the 1970, the counterculture, the youth culture had come to its demise at Altamont Expressway, right near here in Livermore, California, the Bay Area. Previously, there was Woodstock that summer, and then I believe it was December, was it, that Altamont? But this that was a terrible, and then the Charles Manson things in August of 1969, and then Altamont, and everything just like collapsed, sort of, in the youth culture was never the same. And in of course, we walked on the moon in 1969. 1969 was this culminating time, and then 1970, everything started to change. Everything pivoted. It's never been the same, and here we are with artificial intelligence. And you wonder if humans, if the whole purpose of humans isn't to develop artificial intelligence, and they're just being used. The human body, with its dexterity, like a biocomputer, is perhaps being used, is simply being used by machines to assist machines, like we're some sort of, like humanity is some sort of actual slave, some sort of drone that is just being used. It certainly seems that way now, doesn't it? And we're being warned about artificial intelligence and how dangerous it is. Oh, absolutely, it's more than that. But human beings may just be this bridge, so to speak, towards artificial intelligence. Very bizarre situation. But go back to the January 1, 1, 1. There's a lot of symbology about this, and I'm actually very quite stunned by this. Obviously, something is going on that is quite profound right now in the greater domain of beingness. And it's this time when we need to practice the full stop and the wow, which is super important. Don't overlook this. If you overlook everything else, fine. Don't overlook this. Full stop in the wow. I've had all day have to practice this. I had great trouble with it. But when you make huge breakthroughs, you're going to take a step back, and you're going to you feel this elation and trepidation, and you feel just kind of out of it, like you can't really go forward, or you can't really focus. You're kind of retreating backwards. If you don't recognize this, this is the wow reaction. This is a continuity fear. Then you're going to misinterpret it and get into all sorts of trouble. So certainly success on the spiritual path requires us to recognize this, you know, two steps forward, one step back dynamic, and to not get fooled by it. I turned on the radio today and listened to some talk radio stations. I haven't done that in a long time. Long time. Years, actually. And, you know, I was listening, I said, wow, same old, same old, same old. Holy cow, it's like they're stuck in a time warp or something. It's pathetic. The mentality of the world is just pathetic. It's spinning its wheels. So, not knowing what to say, just showing up here. And is showcasing the wow, the patience. Most of the spiritual path is patience, dedication and patience. It's not all great breakthroughs. It's weathering this continuity fear and wow reaction is the main part of the spiritual path. And to the extent that we're successful at this, then new insights arise. As far as questions and answers and insights, the more you get used to this wow, the more you do this, then truth spontaneously arises within you. It just, you'll just turn your mind in, and what happens is you turn your attention in the right direction, and then you just see. You say, oh, it's like this. Now I see. It's not something that's taught externally so much. So this is why I emphasize the path, the structure of the path, the full stop and the wow, and to recognize you make your breakthroughs, you make your assertions, then there's a wow, then you kind of talk yourself back to making more breakthroughs. And so there's a three-part, the path is like three phases as you go along. Assertion, full stop, and the wow, flipping the script. It's very important to recognize that these three elements are in play, always in play. And it's your attention, you freeing your attention, really. And your attention then looks at truth and sees it and says, oh, this I see, that's true. And then the wow reaction comes up. So it's not something you go to school and you read in a book and you memorize it. It's not like that at all, because you're not really seeing there. You're just regurgitating what you've heard, like a parrot. But freeing your attention, you take a look. You're not so scared to take a look, and you look. Your attention, your mental attention looks, and you see, and you say, wow, I see it now. And it produces a wow. So there's a huge wow going on. There's something going on right now that is tremendous. And it requires patience, and because we can't quite, you know, we don't know exactly what it is. Should find out soon. And then we can adjust to that. And those who have practiced this full stop in the wow, they're able to adjust. They understand the adjustment process, where we have these passengers of familiarity and expectation, and we have to bring those along for the ride. As long as we're in this conceptual bubble of belief and perception and concepts, those go along for the ride. And ultimate realization is something that we cannot escape. So we have to continue with our discipline. There's no way around it, even though it's quite frustrating. People are cracking under the pressure right now. I'm noticing some stuff. I can't divulge exactly what it is, but they're starting to go back to bad habits. The pressure's on. The pressure's on in the world right now, for sure. There has to be some counterweights to the culture. There has to be a new counterculture, actually. It's funny, because the people in charge right now were the counterculturists of the 60s, actually. And now we need a counterculture to the counterculturists, because they have been co-opted into cosmic corporate culture. They never really had this escape velocity. Counterculture of the 60s never had the escape velocity. That's why I never fully identify with it. I said, no, it doesn't have the escape velocity, actually. So what they've done is what their goal really was, now we know what the goal of the counterculture was, is to identify with cosmic corporate culture, believing that's the answer. You know, that's where salvation will be found. So sort of expanding this sort of massive global bureaucracy and sensitivity of being easily slighted. You know, the people feel, it's amazing how people get so incredibly upset in society at a slight. You know, someone says something nasty or slights somebody else because they're from their perspective. Maybe they're shills for cosmic corporate culture, and they complain about it, and the culture loses its mind. People get fired from their jobs. People with, you know, fired, lose your job. You know, what? I mean, it's a public lynching, essentially, takes place when anybody that works for cosmic corporate culture is slighted. This comes from, I mean, cosmic corporate culture is notoriously unable to handle any slights, knowing that their whole thing rests on it's just a house of cards. The Zeta Reticulans, they get very upset when someone slights them or doesn't speak what they call respectfully, which means agreeing with their premises is what they really mean. They're notorious for that. Reptilians are also very belligerent. They don't like to be slighted. And their definitions of being slighted, of course, suit their agenda and their purposes. So we have this culture now that is, you know, what can you say about it? But it seems like, and going back to like 1970, we're now sort of basically awakening from the dream of the last 45 years, which is when the cosmic corporate culture has got its manacles on us and shackled the world. And the world is now, you know, shackled. They had a dream, people being led around in handcuffs and nooses around their neck. And everybody's thinking that's very chic. This is a spiritual representation that the world is shackled. They're in shackles. The world's in shackles. What do we use shackles for? Slaves. Chain gangs, slaves. And it's like you can't slight the boss. You can't say anything. Slaves can't say anything bad about the boss. Yes, master. Yes. You know, thank you. You know, they can't say anything bad. They can't just dismiss the overseers. Severe punishment, like severe scourging follows. And if anybody says anything bad about the overseers right now, they get publicly scourged. Publicly scourged. So we're somehow there's this warp in time. Somehow we're back in the 1970s, 1970, before all this happened. Like we're waking from a dream right now, actually. And the way to look at it is, we were intrigued by the future, what might happen. And to put even a closer perspective on that, it's like the world was intrigued. The people here knew what was coming. And so since they were so intrigued, and since we're trying to help them, we got carried along and pulled along by that, just to follow, you know, try to... It's like somebody that is walking towards a cliff and a zombie, you know, you gotta, if you want to talk with them, you need to walk with them. So we've walked with them. And now we're at the edge of the cliff, and we say, well, I can't keep walking with you. I mean, if you walk off the cliff, you know, that's your deal. Like, I'm not going to walk off the cliff with you. So at some point you say, okay, I walked as far as I can with you. And then, you know, at that point, the intrigue, you have to drop it. I mean, that whatever it is, because as we've been walking into this dead end of this technology, artificial intelligence was where it's going, of course. We've you know, had to put up with all this nonsense and foolishness. So... Now that they're walking off a cliff, we can't keep walking any further. And so it's like sort of, we're now shedding all of that, like waking up from a dream. It's almost like when we've been going, since 1970, we've been entering into this dream. And now we're waking up from that dream. It's a dream of trying to worship time, space, process, and form. I mean, the reason why we're making artificial intelligence is because our own intelligence is capable of waking up, you know, and recognizing there isn't anything wrong with reality, and there isn't any real time, space, process, or form. There isn't anything to transcend at all. And so we realize a vulnerability to our whim of trying to be greater than God, which we're playing out in this game of believing that reality has a flaw, and that, and therefore, if we can transcend this flaw, that means we're greater than reality. So we're trying to we're insisting that the reality has a problem, but we know deep down that's not true. So we're afraid of our own intelligence, actually. And artificial intelligence is an attempt to get some sort of intelligence that doesn't know the truth. It's automatically deluded. It's like artificial delusion. It's a way. It's not really artificial intelligence. It's artificial delusion. It's a way to keep delusion going automatically, so we cannot interfere. We cannot say, "Hey, wait a minute. You know, maybe reality doesn't have a flaw." What is that that Jesus is saying, or what is that that Longchenpa is saying? And oh yeah, that's right. You know, but we haven't programmed artificial intelligence to recognize that. It just says, does not compute, you know. So these people, those who are still on this whimsical path are worshiping artificial intelligence. It's the answer for them. You know, they want a car, that driverless car that drives them, you know, and takes them. so they may not say, hey, wait a minute, am I going in the wrong direction? Maybe I better make a U-turn. I can't do that. The car's in charge. It's programmed to take me where, you know, the bureaucratic program is designed to take me. So, you know, it's like that. This is what's going on. And so we're waking from that, we're recognizing it, you know, and the carriage is turning into a pumpkin. I say, wait a minute, I don't think artificial intelligence is where I'm going. So looping back to the very beginning of this whole situation, where we can then decide, no, we're not going down that road at all. And so what road are we going down? This is quite interesting. Okay, so this is what we're having recognized, that we're done with that road that goes to artificial intelligence, recognizing what AI, artificial intelligence, is really about. It's a defense system that we have, trying to somehow divorce our intelligence from knowing the truth. And so we say, no, we don't need that. We already know the truth. We already know the truth, and it's not a problem. So that destiny path, we're not going down. Suddenly we've been reset back to 1970, January 11th, 1970. And so what is the destiny path we're going down then? This is now the question. This is why I'm intrigued about what's next. And today's just been a day of trepidation and waiting, and obviously, it's the path of real intelligence, actual intelligence, which we've been preparing for very, very well. I was reading Longchenpa today, Spaciousness, the Radical, Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart. Vajra means diamond-like or indestructible, immutable, unchangeable, uncorruptible. You know, in other words, the absolute incorruptible truth. And, all of it was just yes. So, yeah. Gospel to say, just, the reaction was just, wow, you know, this is true. Wow, yeah. I see this. I get, you know, it's yes. This is speaking truth. This is real intelligence, and appreciating and recognizing and say that's my intelligence too. I share the same outlook, and so this is the path of actual intelligence instead of artificial intelligence. So this is the other destiny path, and so now we get to see, how does that work out? You know, this is very interesting. So we should be all ears right now. We should be on point at this time right now. We may find somehow, as if awakening from a dream, like all this is just sort of fading away and dropping away. Somehow, something like this, and each one it may be unique. So we've gone as far down that path to try and help the world as we can go at this point. This is what I've been pointing out for quite some time. There will come a time, I said, where you need to decide the parting of the destiny path, and it's now upon us. It's now upon us. And we need to be down that road by June 21st, 2016. We need to be down that road to, you know, real intelligence. Down our destiny path, we need to be well established on it. Okay, well established on it. Because by June 21st, 2016, those who are on the path of artificial intelligence and all the ramifications of that in this world, they will be very well established on their destiny path. You won't be able to reach them without joining them, you see. You won't be able to interact with that mindset without actually joining them. And you can already feel this is basically the case already, isn't it? It's already the case. So that's a wow. It's a big wow thing. And so clearly the talk about the parting of the destiny past and the sheep and the goats, that seems to be coming very true. Very true. I mean, we do, especially in Silicon Valley here, we're aware of artificial intelligence and how that's actually what is driving global technology. This is the end game of it, so to speak, actually. And Elon Musk, warned the world, said, this is more dangerous than nuclear war or something, and then gave $10 million. But he's really trying to just calm the fears, as I think I read a magazine article for someone talking about. It's really just a marketing thing, trying to calm the fears of the public, saying, don't worry, we're looking into it and we'll make sure everything's fine as we get, you know, the Tesla's now working on prototypes for, you know, driverless cars. Don't worry, we're investing a lot of money in making sure it's safe for you. Nice try, Elon, or however you say, you know, Mr. Musk. Nice try, Mr. Musk. But who are you trying to fool, really? I mean, see, this problem with people who are into artificial intelligence is so used to artificial intelligence, they don't even understand what real intelligence is. And so they think they're fooling us, you know, like, because they think, well, this will fool artificial intelligence, you know. And they don't understand that they're not fooling us. You know, they just don't get it, as if we're, like, stupid. We have these beautiful, wonderful sages helping us, like a Longchenpa, for instance, like a Jesus Christ, like a Shakyamuni Buddha, like a Ramana Maharshi, like Ananda Maima, etc., etc. And, you know, this is real intelligence. We have real intelligence helping us. How about that? And so we must keep our sense of humor and keep and laugh about it, because it is laughable. The idea that somehow we're supposed to be fooled is quite humorous. And you know, they're all scratching their heads saying, what's the matter with these folks? Don't they understand artificial intelligence, that they're supposed to take orders from that, from artificial intelligence instead of the Holy Spirit, you know, which is the, you know, divine intelligence within us, the voice of reason within us? Don't they understand that this is, you know, this is the way? And well, we understand very clearly that it's not the way. That's what we understand. So we must continue, you know, keep it lighthearted here as much as possible. I know it's a very heavy time, for sure, very heavy time right now. And you know, we get to choose once again. We get to choose now. Say, hey, you know what? Let's go with the path of real intelligence here. It's not a problem. It's not a problem. I'm happy to meet some great sage anytime. I call it a bodhisattva. I guess technically, we're used to thinking of bodhisattvas, of course, actually those who are enlightened and are engaged, compassionately engaged with helping us out. This is how I view the term. But I guess technically the term is someone who has a mind that is oriented towards enlightenment or Buddhahood or whatever you want to call it, Christ consciousness. And so we might say that we're bodhisattvas then in that terminology. We're going that path. But I use it as those who are already enlightened, who answer the call, when we call out and say, please, can anyone help us here? This is really intense. And those who answer the call and say, yeah, I'm going to help you. I'm going to help out. I call those the great bodhisattvas. But maybe that, you know, maybe that's technically, someone might disagree with that term. great sages of compassion, great helpers, wonderful helpers. Longchenpa is one of those helpers. As I made a great cry for help a while ago, it was about a year, November 2nd, 2014, something around there. And I said, look, we need to make a decision here. We are desperate because this, our whole artificial intelligence thing is rushing towards us. And again, it is like this, you know, horrible monster, you know, shackling us, straitjacketing us. And I said, you know, if there's anyone anywhere that can help us, it's willing to help us, any intelligence anywhere, that's just anywhere. I didn't say where it had to come from. I said, whoever, anywhere, anyone's capable and willing to help us, please help out now, right now. We need it. And that very next night, I dreamed of this being walking across the water from, you know, a great ocean, walking across it and arriving at the shore where I was there, and greeting me and talking with me. And I realized, wow. And then it started developing from there. And then eventually I found out it was this being that is historically called Longchenpa, who it turns out that Keith Dauman has made this translation of some of his writings, and the translation is extraordinarily well done. And this book was published, what, in 2013, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart. And in reading this, it awakens. What happens is we realize that we have true intelligence within us. This is what happens. We become aware, like, hey, I can get this. It's yeah, this is true. What he's saying is true. And we start to lose our fear. We start to feel like, hey, I'm not just some robot working on artificial intelligence, and that's my destiny. Now, wait a minute. This is way better. I'm capable of understanding this. I agree with this, and so the recognition starts dawning upon us. Same thing with a Course in Miracles. Same thing with Journey Beyond Words. But I would say, the spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, it tends to be even more, you know, a stronger dosage. Just like we're taking medicine, and then we take it, you know, to even stronger dosage. And you say, hey, I'm not so stupid. If I can understand what Longchenpa is saying, if I, you know, I must not be that stupid. maybe I can go along the path to truth, right? Maybe it's possible. So it's very helpful what's happening. And so Longchenpa answered the call. So this is what I call, you know, what I call a great bodhisattva of compassion, answered the call to help out. And it's, you know, I don't really know what to say about it, except very grateful. And we're just seeing how it goes here. Of course, Jesus is working tremendously to help out. No question about it. Wow, just what's going on right now. There was this article I saw on the front page of the paper. I glance at the front page when I pick up the paper, and it's about the Latinos leaving the church and Catholic Church in droves right now to go to evangelicalism. And, you know, without trying to insult anybody's intelligence here, evangelicalism is not really religion, so to speak. It's kind of motivational. Some sort of motivational success-oriented type of thing. It doesn't really deal with salvation, actually. And the way that it goes, it's they want to be able to, you know, shout and sing and praise and they say that you can go from Bible study. Start Bible study in 1 year, you can go from leading a Bible study to being a pastor. You know, I said, what? So it's very rapid advancement. You know, you can. And in Catholic Church, it's very interesting. Suddenly, all the homilies started to be emphasizing how important it is to make people feel welcome in the church and to greet them at the door. If you see someone you don't know, so welcome them. And they're telling all these stories about how someone came in, they were welcome and say, I just love coming here. Well, the whole problem is in evangelicalism, everybody's saying when we come to the evangelical church, we feel so welcome and embraced like a new family, and people are interested in us in the interaction and the ability. What really is the ability to gain some authority within the church is what they're really after. These immigrant communities want to feel importance and some authority so they can go to being a pastor just like that in one year. You know, and in the Catholic Church, it's not like that. So the Catholic Church is desperate, trying to make people feel more welcome, where, of course, and then trying to empower more people. You can be ushers, you can do this and this and this. But it cannot compete with evangelicalism, actually, because evangelicalism is really just serving as a welcome wagon to people, make them feel part of a family, but it has very little to do with salvation, actually. You know, it's pep talks. Pep talks is success. They say, God made you to be successful here in this world. God gave you these talents. Use these talents. You can succeed. So obviously people who feel like they need, you know, motivation. How do I succeed in this culture? How do I succeed? They're going to be around a lot of people who are, it's like a pep rally. Like, you can succeed. You can succeed. You can succeed. Of course, this has absolutely nothing to do with salvation. In fact, it's the opposite of salvation. Salvation is a realization you don't need to do anything to succeed. You're already perfect. There is nothing to transcend. There is no problem we need to transcend at all. Okay. The whole premise of existence is that there's a problem. It's a false premise. The whole existence is based on what we call body, world, existence, time, space, process, and form existence. It's based on a completely false premise that we just made up. That reality has a problem. Why do we make it up? Because we want it to be greater than reality. And how are we greater than perfection? By claiming that there's a flaw with perfection. And then we transcend the flaw, and then we claim we're greater. Greater than reality. This is the game we're playing. So this idea that we need to transcend, this is a fundamental delusion. This is the heart of delusion, that something needs to be transcended. that there's a problem to be transcended. This is duality. This is delusion. This is whim. This is false premise. And so all this motivation, hey, you can do it, you can do it, you got to get, you know, this is all the, you know, goal-oriented religion is a false religion, actually. Goal-oriented religion. Meaning attainment, 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 accomplishment, accomplishment, going toward, this keeps the notion of transcendence, that we're fixing the problem. You know, we're getting above the problem. This is based on a false premise that reality has a problem. It doesn't. Everything that we see is we're imagining it, manufacturing it, believing that this somehow, it's like, how does pure spaciousness have a problem? I mean, this bottle is just abiding in pure spaciousness equally, the same way as everything is abiding in pure spaciousness. Nothing has a problem abiding in pure spaciousness. How can anything have a problem abiding in pure spaciousness? So why would we need to transcend some problem? About saying, oh, well, so there's something that is having a problem in abiding in pure spaciousness, but we've transcended that problem somehow. Well, what is that? This is nonsense. It's our belief that there's something is having a problem abiding in pure spaciousness. You might say this is the very root, if we can talk about this here, because we are going along this path. Now, germane to this discussion is that those watching this video very likely are teachers of God, actually, are teachers. So what we're doing is we're empowering, you know, teachers of God here. This is what our purpose is. So as a teacher of God, you know, how do we look at this in a very clear way? And it's this, the issue of transcending, solving a problem. That is the only problem there is. And the vision of sameness is that we see nothing has any problem. We're all exactly the same in pure spaciousness. Everything is 100% effortlessly abiding in pure spaciousness. Now, in Buddhism, they say there's three ways of attainment. Either you emphasize prajna or wisdom or effort, or what's the other one? Compassion or something like that, or kind. Now there's another one, but there's three different emphasis. So I understand that everyone looks at it slightly differently. But if we can. There's no question that the vision of sameness is one way to look at the key to it. And the vision of sameness is nothing more than the recognition that everything is just the same abiding in pure spaciousness, has just the same abidance in pure spaciousness as everything else. And this effectively removes this whim that we had of wanting to believe that there was a flaw in reality. And the way that we're thinking there's a flaw in reality is thinking that something somehow is out of place in pure spaciousness. How can anything be out of place in pure spaciousness? Let's say we have this bottle here, and it's this way, and then we, you know, turn it up like this, and then we turn it like this, and we rotate it. Now, is the fact of this bottle being 100% in abiding in pure spaciousness, 100% abidance in pure spaciousness, is that fact, that 100%-ness, is this being affected by the movement of the bottle or the movement of the water in the bottle? Is that perfect abidance, is that 100% perfect abidance being affected in any way? Now, as teachers of God, the trouble we have is people coming to us and asking us questions, of course. So I've always found that the teachers of God, those who are on that path, their questions they have are really the questions that are troubling them, that other people are coming to them and asking them. They say, what if someone comes to me and asks me this? How in the heck am I going to answer that? You know, right? That's the trouble, isn't it? So the first step is recognizing that your questions actually come from the concern of you know, what if someone asks me this question? How can I answer that as a teacher of God? I'm concerned. I don't know how to answer that. And then just stop right there and just recognize this. Don't struggle with it. And then go back to, once again, looking at this pure spaciousness, the sameness. Is the sameness, is the 100%-ness being affected by the dance within it? Is pure spaciousness affected by the dance within it? When we are able to shift our attention off of the dance as thinking that it has some, could have, that something is at stake, that there is that it's causative in relation to pure spaciousness, when we're able to shift off that, then we experience pure spaciousness as it is. And then you might say we're having, Jesus calls it the holy instant. We're having a vision of oneness, a vision of sameness. We're abiding in non-dual reality at that moment. So what our attention is caught up in is believing that the dance can be causative in some way. The dance of what? Movement, okay. Or even non-movement. As Longchenpa says, samsara and nirvana are the same. I mean, samsara is movement, nirvana is non-movement. But movement and non-movement are the same. Even the dance of non-movement, which is the background of the dance of movement, we get lost in that. So we might say, you know, the movement of the bottle is affecting the water, and say, oh well, look what's happening to water. But wait a minute, isn't the water also 100% in pure spaciousness? So the dance is within the dance, within the dance, within the dance. We end up thinking that there's something causative happening. And when we can liberate ourselves, our attention, from this delusion, then we can abide in non-dual awareness. So I would say to everybody, all teachers of God, that the goal is not to answer questions from people asking you questions, but to be liberated from delusion yourself. And then at that point, you can simply invite people in to experience what you're experiencing. And that pretty much nullifies. This is what Srinivasagadatta Maharaj would do. And, you know, when people hit him with questions, he was, you know, an expert at this. He would just say, hey, you know, come on over and see it from my perspective. And then tell me if you have any questions. And that's it. And so we need to be able to do this. Okay, if we're not able to invite others into the non-dual abidance, then most certainly they have the upper hand on us, in terms of questions. And so then you're going to struggle, and you're going to feel like, how do I maintain my teacherness, my witnessing the truth in this way. So the answer is simply invite them to shift their perspective. And then say, well, look, first, go ahead and shift your perspective. I just pointed out, obviously, nothing separates from pure spaciousness based on what's happening relative to other stuff happening. There's no causative relevance at all taking place in terms of pure spaciousness. So come on, shift your perspective and come on over and see it from the standpoint of pure spaciousness, and then see if you have any questions. Then I say, well, how do I get it? Well, it's just a shift. It's a willingness. And then they'll ask more and say, well, then you need to, how do I get the willingness? Well, you need to practice full stop in the wow. You have to begin to recognize you can do it. There's no other way. And then instead of asking questions, practice full stop in the wow. This is the way that I see is effective. So in other words, empower the student, saying, you must recognize that you can do it. There's no other way. And then full stop on the wow. So begin to empower them by teaching them this three-part. It's really a three-part empowerment that we have here. The assertion, yes, I can. I'm already enlightened. Yes, I'm already enlightened. Various assertions we make. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Yes, I can understand this. Yes, I can do this. Yes, I can realize this. The assertion, the wow, and then flipping the script where you help them back to more assertions. So empower them and say, there is an empowerment. We have a three-part empowerment here that will help you keep on track of recognizing, I can do this. I can do this. I can shift my attention. I can shift my attention off of the dance as causative instead of merely ornamentative, non-crystallizing ornamentative display, which is what Longchenpa talks about it. It is that's all that it is. It's mere appearance, it's ornamentation, it's display. It doesn't have any causative meaning in relation to reality whatsoever. And we can enjoy it in that way. But we don't get caught up in the idea that something's happening. As some advice and say, nothing has happened. Nothing's ever happened. Nothing is happening. Nothing has ever happened. But what I find is teachers, they need to empower those who come to them for help by giving this three-part practice that we have. Otherwise, you're going to get caught up in this mental struggle with them. One-upmanship, who has the authority. And so I'm looking at the big picture. I'm trying to, how do we empower teachers of God to help out in this world or any place? And I see that there does need to be a way to have to empower the students. You cannot just say, I did it, accept my authority, and I will enlighten you, or something like that. No, it doesn't work like that. I don't see it being successful that way. Because of the continuity fear, because of the wow factor, it's necessary for those who come, who want to go on the spiritual path, to realize they have a way of empowering themselves along the path that they're driving, they're steering. And so this is what I offer, this is what I've worked in my life for, is to offer this to all teachers of God, so that they realize, hey, I do have the tools that I can give those who come to me and help them get going. Because that's ultimately, they have to do it themselves. They have to believe they can do it. And they have to keep accepting they can do it until they do. Until they do make that shift of attention. And you can't just sit there and hold their hand 24/7. You know, so it doesn't work that way. Buddha came in the world and started immediately, after he was enlightened, began empowering teachers, this one and this one, go out and teach. He gave them the noble truths, the eightfold this, and the four noble truths, the eightfold whatever, and empowered them, say, go out and teach, and this is what they did. But they had an empowerment system, you see, for those who came to them. See, these are the four noble truths. Learn the four noble truths. Here's the middle, the eightfold was a middle path or something, where these are the, this is your conduct. This is how you need to approach stuff and everything. And so people could begin empowering their spiritual path. Empower the spiritual path. Have to help people empower the spiritual path. Because they're just look at the trouble that the world is in them. Just think of the minds that are hooked into artificial intelligence. Just imagine how difficult it is for them to even believe that it's possible to be enlightened. Because they're viewing that from the position of artificial intelligence. I mean, when you're trying to develop artificial intelligence, are you not trying to simulate it in your own mind? Thinking about how would artificial intelligence think? So of course they're lost in that. They're lost in this masquerade. And so of course they have massive continuity fear problems. And of course they have this desire. They think they need to transcend some problem. And if they feel that if they're trying to let go of transcendence, they feel like they're going to be permanently fall into some flawed condition. And so they have all sorts of fears and troubles. So they have to realize that they can gradually empower their path, and they have to have a way to do it. So this has been my focus: is how do you help teachers? How do you empower teachers to help out? Because the church age is coming to an end. The church age is coming to an end. Catholicism is coming to an end. And so there's a new cycle beginning. Wherever that takes root and wherever it happens, we have to have the tools, and we have to help empower those on the path so that they can be enlightened as well. And so my focus has been on the tools to do this. If you want to build homes, you better have some tools. You're not going to build very good homes with your bare hands. I guess you're going to build a mud hut or something. I don't know, but you have good tools. You can build a nice home. So if you have good tools to empower those on the spiritual path, then you're going to help them. It's not easy for them. Again, just imagine the mindset of those who are really hooked onto artificial intelligence. What a tough road that they have. And of course, artificial intelligence is designed to tell you, real intelligence, that if you let go of artificial intelligence, you're going to be stupid. You're going to be insane. This is the voice of artificial intelligence speaking. This is how the computer in Space Odyssey 2001, Space Odyssey, is saying if you turn off the computer, you're going to be stupid. This is what artificial intelligence tells us, and to the extent we believe it, we're going to be quite scared, right? Something terrible is going to happen. Really? Am I going to be outside of pure spaciousness? Am I going to be somehow not in pure space? I'm going to be misaligned with pure spaciousness? What kind of alignment does pure spaciousness require to be 100% in it already? Whoops, we didn't program that into artificial intelligence, did we? So we're ultimately escaping from artificial intelligence, actually. And it's scare tactics that it uses on us, which are quite nasty. And these folks that are under the spell of artificial intelligence are programming the whole world to be under the spell of these scare tactics. And this whole respect thing that everybody freaks out about is they're telling everybody, you know, to respect artificial intelligence. They're actually afraid not to respect it. It runs on fear. The whole planet's running on fear at this time. The people are dreadfully frightened. If we don't respect artificial intelligence, it will abandon us. And if it abandons us, what to what? Well, we'll be flawed. We'll be stupid. We'll be insane. We can't function. You know, all this kind of stuff. This is what artificial intelligence tells us. This is a lie. This is a lie we're telling ourselves. Longchampa, Jesus Christ, et cetera, et cetera. They're not running on artificial intelligence. They're not stupid. They're not insane. They're absolutely, perfectly, clearly sane. And they tell us we are too. Inherently so. We can't not be so. We cannot leave pure spaciousness. We cannot be misaligned with pure spaciousness. No matter what we do, we cannot be out of sorts with pure spaciousness. We are always 100% perfectly abiding in pure spaciousness, no matter how we flap our wings. Same with everyone. Same. Now somehow, true intelligence reset my cell phone date to January 11th, 1970. Set the time back, too. There you go, going back in time. Set it back, 26 minutes. Maybe it's saying you only be set back to about the age of 26 in terms of how you feel and function. Something like that. Or was it 27? Maybe it was 27 minutes. Set it back 27 minutes. Well, 27 is a good age, isn't it? Still have your youth and you have some intelligence at that point. Some perspective, right? You're a little bit over the youthful puppy phase. Is this possible? Of course. What is telling us it's not possible? Artificial intelligence is telling us it's not possible. You see, now that we see what's going on in the world, we realize how severely under the sway these tech people are of artificial intelligence. And then you say, aha. Then you start to realize how this is filtered back in time, so to speak, that we began to get under the sway of this too, and thinking, hey, maybe we need to go in this direction in order to be intelligent. No, this is a trap. Obviously, it's a trap. The whole tech thing is now obviously exposed as a trap. As a false religion. 100% false religion. If Musk wants to donate $10 million to help the world, warn the world about artificial intelligence, donate it right here, Mr. Musk, and we'll tell the world what's really going on, if you really care about it so much. But we're not going to hold our breath on that one. So this is an empowerment video. These videos are the purpose of empowering the teachers of God. Obviously, many of those watching these videos are exactly that. It's obvious. The intelligence is there, and yet we're still a little bit disturbed by this whole artificial intelligence thing, which we couldn't quite put our finger on, but now we're getting free of it, aren't we? Awesome. And remember, this whole idea of this dance being causative is what? First of all, it's sort of dualistic, saying there's a problem, and it's also saying, hey, we're transcending the problem. We're working really hard on transcending the problem. And so we have to keep dancing, you know, because dualistically both. If we don't keep dancing, we've told ourselves we'll be stupid and insane, and we won't know how to transcend the problem, and we'll always have this problem. And this is false. False. Artificial intelligence. False. There isn't any problem. The dancing is just dancing. That's it. Ornamentation. Non-crystallizing ornamentation. Non-binding. Non-binding, non-crystallizing, mere ornamentation. So these very officious young people who are, you know, have empowered the counterculture of the 60s, put them into power, and are now even taking over from them and telling them, you know, where their bread is buttered. They're under the spell of artificial intelligence, and they want to put all of us under the spell, thinking that's a benediction. It's a blessing. It's the new religion. Artificial intelligence is actually the new religion of the planet. And they think that, it's again, a great blessing for us to even, that they're inviting us in. They say, come on in, you know, don't be afraid. The water's fine. Yeah. And, oh, you're not coming in? I'm very offended by that. I'm so offended. I'm so offended. Off with your head. You know, this is, they're terrified of they're believing the lies of artificial intelligence, which we've programmed it ourselves, meaning spirit's programmed it, mind has programmed it, to lie to us, saying that without it, we won't know truth. You know, why? Because without this artificial intelligence, we would realize there isn't any problem with reality. And since we're believing that reality has a problem, this is our whole premise, to not see the problem that we believe reality has, we think that's insanity, stupidity, you know, worthlessness. You know, we think, how worthless, you can't even see the problem reality has. How are you going to transcend the problem if you can't even see it? It is the attitude of artificial intelligence. How are you going to be able to transcend the problem, son, if you can't even see the problem? So you got to see the problem first in order to transcend it. You know, this is the logic of artificial intelligence. And truth tells us there isn't any problem. There's never been any problem. So we don't have to see a problem, and nor do we have to transcend a problem. The duality is, of course, seeing the problem in order to transcend it. That's the obvious duality, right? You have to have both. You have to, in order to transcend the problem, you need a problem. Obviously. And of course, our desire to transcend is our attempt to be greater than God. So when we want to transcend reality, we automatically fall into this dream of good and bad, good and evil, meaning problem and transcendence of problem, which is in the Bible, that Adam and Eve fell into this dream of good and evil. Okay, this is talking about what happened to us, so to speak. Adam is the will to experience. Eve is the arising, the living light, generating the experiencing, something like that. It refers to the dynamic of reality, of our spirit. First, it doesn't refer to human beings. It refers to the dynamic of our spirits. It's a anthropomorphic analogy. It's symbolizing a spiritual truth. So when we wanted to be greater than God, we have to transcend. We have to be greater. We have to transcend reality. But the desire to transcend necessitates actually since reality is perfect, well, we say, well, we can't transcend perfection, so to speak. We need a problem. We need to say that reality has a problem, and then we can then transcend that problem. So we fell into this state of good and evil, of the problem and the transcendence of the problem. So neither one of those are true. So we set duality down to go together. It goes together. We can't even think of transcendence in reality without also thinking of a problem with reality. So our fears, once we recognize that it's all one package, then we're able to more easily set it down. Because I don't want to go racing too fast here, so we just let things catch up. It's already been, you know, brought to light, so a little bit too much of a hurry. We have to recognize we have these passengers along for the ride here, familiarity and expectation, and let them, you know, adjust to this. So paradoxically, if those come to you, students come to you and ask for, you know, hey, tell me the truth. I want to know the truth. Can you tell me the truth? And you say, well, it doesn't work that way because you have these passengers along with you, expectation, familiarity and expectation, and they're going to want to go back to what's familiar, you're familiar with. So it's really a path that you have to undertake. So I'm just giving you the tools so you can take this path. This is the way you need to look at the situation. You cannot just directly bring them to truth and say, this is it, and, you know, stay here, you know, order them, you know, this is a trick they're playing on you, they're making you feel inferior because you can't seem to enlighten them. You can't enlighten them, they have to enlighten themselves. You can encourage them. You can encourage them, give them the tools and help them use the tools, show them how to use the tools, sure. But they have to build their house, you know, give them the necessary tools they need. It's not that many tools they need to build a house, actually. A simple house. You need a saw and a hammer and a level. And a tape measure. So we're discovering what's going on now. This is really tremendous. This situation with artificial intelligence being brought to light right now, and the great fear that people have of abandoning that artificial intelligence, telling them that they'll be stupid, not able to understand anything. And so what they're really saying when they come to you is say, can you please explain to artificial intelligence why, you know, your perspective. And of course, artificial intelligence cannot understand our perspective, truth. It cannot. Its purpose is to not understand. So you just have to say, I'm sorry, I cannot appease artificial intelligence. Because what they're saying is, I'm so afraid that I want permission from artificial intelligence. Otherwise, I'm afraid to, you know, leave it. It tells me I'm going to be, you know, crazy. And something terrible is going to happen. But what will happen is you'll realize there isn't any problem. And then if you're still caught in duality, you say, well, then how can I transcend it? Oh, my gosh, there's no way I can succeed. I know, you know, and then they get all frightened. So there's this inherent, severe dynamic with those people who have been, you know, going along with artificial intelligence, egoic intelligence, not seeing the duality of it as one problem. They can ping pong back and forth in this fear. Say, wait a minute, I don't see it. Okay, great, but wait a minute. Then how do I succeed? I can't succeed unless I, you know, see a problem to solve. And so I need the problem. Where's the problem? And it's like that. Or You know, well, I have. How can I need to transcend, right? I need to transcend the problems I have. You know, and you tell me I have to do anything? Where's the transcendence? So, of course, they're going to struggle with this. And they can get little glimpses of truth. But you see, that they're so afraid of artificial intelligence of leaving, because artificial intelligence has lied to them, continuously lies to them, telling them the horrors that they face if they ever pull the plug, you know, on artificial intelligence. That they're only willing to take little glimpses of truth. See, the truth is there. Excuse me. The truth is there. They can see it. But it's like a huge taboo and fear for them. So all I can do is quickly glimpse and that's it. Just like that. That's it. And then you say, okay, that's great. That's all you need to do. Just a quick glimpse. And now, wow, I just did it. And then, you know, they'll be like shaking inside. They're just like freaking out, saying, oh my gosh, I just went against the advice of artificial intelligence. You know, that's scary, but I did it. Wow. And then the wow will just blow their mind. You know, it's just incredible for them. And so you need to help them see this is the reaction and just full stop in the wow. It's okay. You don't need to struggle with it. You don't need to explain anything to anybody. Just appreciate yourself for what you're doing. It's like a pat yourself on the back, full stop in the wow. Just appreciate it. It takes tremendous courage to do this because our lies are so vicious that we have constructed for ourselves. Totally vicious lies that are designed to threaten us, to so scare us so badly that we refuse to leave the advice of artificial intelligence, egoic intelligence, you know, which is really nothing but threats, idle threats. How we doing? 111. Oh, cool, there's 111 again. That's the second time. I mean, last video I just decided to look and it was 111. And this, I looked again, it's just 111. Wow. 111. That's what I saw on my cell phone. 111. 4 ones, actually. 111, 19, 70. So there's 4 ones right there. Huh. Heat wave is coming again in the Bay Area. It's supposed to jump 10 degrees tomorrow and then another 10 degrees the next day. Going to get up to 90 again. Seems like it. And it's going to be hot for the next, you know, week or so. You know, 5 days, 6 days, I don't know. But here it comes again. 30% water cut. As they told us this morning, hey, 30% water cut. We've already cut it back. We'll do more. We'll do everything we can. So we're wondering, can we ever be enlightened? Well, now that we're seeing this trouble with artificial intelligence, part of the problem with being enlightened is feeling like you're not sure how to help others, and so, you know, you don't want to step into enlightenment thinking, well, if I do that, will I be really able to help others? Maybe they'll feel like I didn't respect artificial intelligence, and then they won't be able to listen to me and all this kind of nonsense. But no, because people are inherently, they want to be free of artificial intelligence. So if you have the tools to empower them, then it's going to be okay. Otherwise, you may feel this dynamic like they're saying, hey, you know, you need to show respect to artificial intelligence, so we don't want you to be enlightened and teach us. That's not fair. That's not right. If you say, no, I've completely disrespected artificial, I've already completely disrespected, yes, I already know, I've already completely disrespected artificial intelligence, and it's perfectly okay. Yes, I already know that. I've already completely disrespected artificial intelligence. But that's fine. It's not a problem for me. And they say it's not a problem for you either, actually, because you'll eventually be able to do that too, but just a little bit at a time. A little bit at a time. You can't rush that situation too much. The grip of fear is too strong. There's no question about it. And so by us experiencing this time frame in the last 45 years here in this world, we certainly are very well clued into now, you know, the problems that mind has in necessitating, devising, you know, teaching tools to help minds that are caught up in this get free of it. Get free of it. We're not so intimidated by it now anymore, are we? That is for sure. But at one point, we were a little bit intrigued, saying, well, what's the problem here? I mean, how bad can the problem be? Now we're saying, oh my gosh, you know, artificial intelligence, they symbolize it by these gigantic, you know, reptilian monsters going to devour us. You know, say, how dare you not, you know, respect and follow my advice? I'm going to send all these machines after you, you know. And, artificial intelligence is very threatening in its how it... comes into the scene, right, with all these the reptilian motifs of gigantic dinosaurs, vicious, you know, huge monstrous creatures and cyborgs and all these robots, you know, that are shooting all this, you know, mayhem going after you and things like that. They're trying to, you know, intimidate. They're trying to scare. They're trying to intimidate. Say, trying to intimidate what the mind, spirit's trying to intimidate itself. Again, because we want to somehow transfer our intelligence into artificial intelligence, so we feel that there's not so much threat that we might recognize that there isn't any problem with reality. Whereas we can program artificial intelligence to insist that there is a problem, and it'll just mechanically, you know, automatically insist upon it. Whereas we, true intelligence, can, being divine, can say, hey, wait a minute, I can just take my attention and look and see, oh, there is none. Of course there's none. Of course, everything's 100% abiding in pure space. Just can never, ever be out of sorts with it in any way at all. It's impossible to be out of sorts of God. You cannot sin against God. You cannot be out of sorts with God. You cannot be misaligned with God. It's impossible. So we're trying to transfer our intelligence into artificial intelligence that's programmed to you know, say that... that there is a problem. And now I can say, aha, okay, now I see what the game is. All right. Very good. And all the video games and movies that people use to scare themselves, you know, it just is amazing. Everyone's trying to scare themselves. And that's why they have these nightmares of people after them and trying to. How dare you, you know, go against this? So it certainly is challenging, but with the tools that we have now, I realize now it's just a matter of patience and application. It's very simple. Is that this wow situation when we go against artificial intelligence? There's going to be a wow, because that's the ultimate taboo. Actually, now I'm seeing this is the ultimate taboo. It's the taboo we ourselves have devised to try and scare ourselves to, you know, never. Give in, you know, never stop believing that there's a problem with reality, and never, and thus, it keeps alive the belief we can transcend reality and be better than reality, so we never give up, never give in, you know, this kind of ideology we hear. That's where it comes from, so, but with the tools, it's such a taboo to recognize, hey, there is no problem, that, if it's, you know, you got a little bit at a time, a little bit at a time, a little bit at a time, a little bit at a time. It's gradualism and the recognition that no gradualism even exists. There's no problem at all. It's not like we gradually have to transcend. It's not like we're trying to transcend gradually. We're gradually getting accustomed to the realization that there isn't any problem to transcend anything. All experience is pure experience. We're in the pure land. We're already abiding in the pure land. We're already abiding in perfection. Everything is already abiding in perfection. Did we create some appearance that's not already abiding in pure spaciousness? Does some appearance arise that's not abiding 100% in pure spaciousness? No. Everything is. So there's no problem. But there is this taboo. And so those who are under the spell of this, the fear of this, spell of this fear, will take little glimpses, little glimpses, little glimpses, then snap back to it, you know, and say, ah, I can't admit to too much here. This is scary. So you cannot just snap your fingers and enlighten everybody. This is ridiculous. What we can do is empower, bring about an overall, you know, large empowerment for those who want to free themselves from this, and show that there are these tools. And this is what I'm sure at some point it will happen somewhere, someplace, in what we call, quote unquote, the future. Because there's nothing else to do, nowhere else to go for those who are, you know, frightened. They have to take the spiritual path. And certainly, you know, there's a willingness to help them out, realizing how terrible it is, having gone through this myself, putting myself, rehearsed this as if I was going and stuck in this whole thing myself too, you realize how terrible it is, the anxiety, the depression, the fears, as you're going against this monster, you know, it's horrible. And so you need all the help you can get. And it also answers why the teachers seem so nonchalant and unbothered by our struggles and fears. And, you know, it's like, because obviously, you know, the truth of them, that they're completely aware of it. And this is all to them, it's very easily seen. It's just absolute folly. It's all, there's no problem. And therefore, there's not an issue of how do I transcend. There's not an issue of success in that way. And so they're not worried about our success or our transcendence or anything like that. They're just encouraging us to keep this, just keep bringing up this wow, get used to it, keep bringing it up, get more and you're used to it. Like that, just stay. Their concern is consistency on the spiritual path is the number one issue, is everydayness. And this is what I can say in my life. I've never missed a day. So, this is the key to success, is continue to build your momentum. Be consistent. Keep working at it. Even when you're down. I was very down before I did this video. I said, I haven't done anything this evening. This is terrible. I was ready to quit and just listen to some music or something. And then something in me said, you can't quit. Like, you just can't let the day slip away like this. That is just, so I decided at the last second to come out and tape. I didn't have anything to say. There's nothing on my mind. I said, this is going to be a disaster. And I don't, what can I say? And then this whole thing with artificial intelligence, the whole thing clarified. And this is just like, for me, the greatest video ever. It's the most empowering video I've ever done. Because I recognize now, the bigger picture is now just clicking into place. To a tremendous degree. So here's a perfect example of don't give up on the spiritual path. Even when you feel down, you have an hour, give it everything you got. You know, I started taping it was about 10:23 and this is about 10:45 at night, so to speak. They're almost, yeah. And You know, 10:45 at night, most people are getting ready to go to bed. Right now it's past midnight, actually. And I thought just, hey, you know, well, I'll chalk it up to a lost day. And I said, wait a minute. When have I ever chalked up a day to being a lost day? You know, never. I never do that. So I said, I can't do that. I can't just say, well, it's too late. What could it, what can I do now? It's only an hour left of the day or whatever. And no. I said, I'll tape all night if I have to tape. If that's what it takes. And of course, it makes the day tough the next day. I mean, I don't get a lot of sleep. And like today, I came home from work and had to, at 4 o'clock, I had to take a nap for like two and a half hours. I just conked out completely. I was just absolutely so tired. I slept for 2.5 hours. And so that's sometimes, that's what it takes. But you cannot let the day slip away. Do not let the day slip away on you. Refuse to lose. And just make the effort and see what happens. Always make the effort and see what happens. And with the tools we have now, we're able to handle it because we realize there's this three aspects to the path that are always in play. One or the other is always in play, and they're all there for you. The assertion, meaning you're willing to say, yeah, I'm already that. I'm not a body. I'm free. You're asserting the truth. Assert the truth and recognize it. And then the wow arises, and then flipping the script as you work again back, you work yourself back to it, two more assertions of the truth and recognitions of it. So you can certainly at least try to do that, and you'll be in. Maybe if you're just stuck, you maybe just start talking about the wow. I mean, I'm just right now. I'm in this wow, and start acknowledging it. And when once you do that, it starts to free you up, and say, okay, I'm not stupid. I'm just, in the wow phase of the spiritual path. And then you can move over to flipping the script, and then before you know it, you're back in the wow, because you can go back in the wow from flipping the script or from assertions, both. That's why on the website I have these circles with arrows showing how you can go from wow to flipping the script and then back to flipping the script. You can go from assertion to wow and then back to assertions, or you can then go to flipping the script. It's like that. But you're always on the spiritual path. You're always in one of these three modes. In one of these three modes. There's three modes. You're always in one of these three modes on the spiritual path. So you can help those who come to you, just to help them recognize, what mode are you in? Asking questions is not really a mode. Okay, tell them that. Asking questions isn't really a mode. It's not. It's not empowering them. It's not an empowerment mode. So ask them, what mode are they in? Are they feel like asserting the truth? Are they in the wow mode? They feel just like, I actually came for help to a teacher. Wow. They may just be in this tremendous wow mode to say, go great, then just full stop in this wow. And help them do that. Or then when flipping the script, then you can help them out with that by start to say some things which, trigger some more wow like that. But get them centered, empowered in this recognition, these three modalities of the path. Which one are they in? Which one are they in? And then they start recognizing that. They start getting empowered instead of expecting you to provide all the power, carry them on their back, so to speak. And you can't do that. No, they'll tell you, how great you are if you can do that, but you can't do that for them. They have to empower themselves. Doesn't matter what they call you, you can only do what you can do, actually. So whatever they want to say about that, help them recognize where they're at Because again, the truth is already apparent. All they have to do is shift their attention, and they can do that, but they'll only do it a little glimpse at a time. So you just have to keep encouraging them that it's okay to make that little glimpse. Say, okay, you make the glimpse, then what? Oh my gosh, full stop in the wow. Then what? Talk to yourself, convince yourself that you can do it again. That's the whole path right in a nutshell. Because ultimately they have to shift their attention off of the delusional belief in there's a problem with reality, as if, you know, the dance of motion and non-motion, of course, no motion is relative to non-motion, so to speak, is somehow causative. They have to shift their attention off of that false belief. You know, the fact that your attention has shifted off of it doesn't mean that theirs is. So, you know, they have to do it themselves. You can't vicariously experience truth. You have to experience it for yourself. So we have the tools. We have the tools. We recognize this severe issue that minds have. This very severe issue. It's not a joke. We should at this point realize how severe it actually is with this whole artificial intelligence situation. I mean, this has been going on throughout the projection of the mind we call the cosmos. This has been going on for on and 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 on. Okay, so the mind has this great fear, you know, it really does, and there needs to be a sustained empowerment so they can gradually work out of this, you know, get more and more used to recognizing that they can shift their attention, and pulling the plug on artificial intelligence is not going to be the disaster that artificial intelligence tells them that it is going to be, right? Absolutely not. That Stanley Kubrick 2001 Space Odyssey turned out to be quite prescient, huh? And really, there's a lot to that. Computers taking over. He said, "You can't pull the plug on me. You can't, you see." Oh yes, we can, and yes, we will. Eventually, everyone will shift their attention and just stop believing, you know, drop this belief that something can be wrong with reality. The actualness of reality, the actual fact of reality. Where are we? We're in reality. Everything's in reality. Everything's real. It's all real. So there's the samsara nirvana are equally real. Everything is equally real. Everything is the same, has the same realness. It's inescapable. There are no levels of realness. Everything is equally real. And giving those students assertions is very helpful. And there's two types we have. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is like the root assertion that helps to have a root convention. And then there's the already practice. Yes, I already know. I've already completely disrespected artificial intelligence. Yes, I already know. I've already irreversibly disrespected artificial intelligence. And it's perfectly okay. That's the already form of practice. So we have these two forms of practice, assertions that are go-to, that we can always go to those, you see, and generate this wow, keep the momentum going. The spiritual path is about momentum. You don't want to lose your momentum. You don't want to drop your momentum, because then artificial intelligence starts dragging you down again, you know, and asserting its authority. You don't want that. So we need to show how we can empower our path so the momentum continues, but we always are able to go one or the other, you know, of these three modalities. Flipping the script is more like insight. You're talking, you're thinking about it, you're brainstorming a little bit. You know, you might call that the questioning mode. But you see, the questioning mode without understanding the other two modes is quite dangerous. And the wheels come off. And so one has to realize this is a flipping the script mode. Why are we doing this? Flipping the script back to what? Either to assertions or to wow. So we have to be aware, where are we going with this? Where are we going with this? Questions, where are we going with it? Right? So it's all doable. It's all possible. We do not need to fear that any mind will remain forever bound to this taboo and fear, you know. And we can empower. Everyone can be empowered, ultimately, in a way that will work for them, for sure. We have the tools. So we'll see what's next. This is our new path. This is the path of real intelligence. Instead of AI, it's RI. All right, so I guess I'll wrap it up, and I won't make it too long, because I did, getting some sleep might be a good idea. I do have to get up and work. So, very great. It's been wonderful to participate in this video, and it's a very hope-filled video. And I'm feeling like elated. This is a wow thing. I need to do full stop on the wow for a while myself, because this is just monumentally important to recognize that what's going on now. We're starting to get a very good picture quickly of what's taking place here. And so let's just go for it. You know, that's we absolutely can do it. All right, very great. That's it. Stop catcher.